Welcome to Well Beyond Medicine, the Nemours Children's Health Podcast. Each week, we'll explore anything and everything related to the 80% of child health impacts that occur outside the doctor's office. I'm your host, Carol Vassar, and now that you're here, let's go.
Let's go!
The list of presenters at the 8th World Congress of Pediatric Cardiology and Cardiac Surgery is an impressive one and included more than a few Nemours Children's Health researchers and clinicians. Today, we hear from two of them. Pediatric psychologist Dr. Erica Sood joins us again in this episode to talk about her work improving the emotional health of children with chronic health conditions and her research into the care of moms, dads, and other family members following a prenatal diagnosis of congenital heart disease. First, though, we talk with Dr. Zachary Boynton. Dr. Boynton is co-chief resident at Nemours Children's Health, Florida. His research, presented at the World Congress, centers on heart health in high school athletes and the effectiveness of including an electrocardiogram, or ECG, in a student athlete's pre-participation health screening. It isn't happening everywhere yet, but it is required in Orange County, Florida, where Nemours Children's Hospital is located. But let's back up and learn how cardiac health is traditionally screened for high school athletes. Here's Dr. Zachary Boynton.
So the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Heart Association, and the American Academy of Family Physicians have come out and published guidelines, which is essentially a series of questions and then a physical exam that your primary care providers will do in order to screen the athletes. The questions really are focusing on family history and then symptoms that people have had or young athletes have had during sports, things like, have you ever felt lightheaded or have you ever passed out during exercise? Have you ever had chest tightness or chest pain during exercise? Have you ever had palpitations or like feeling like your heart is fluttering during exercise? And then the family history aspect is, do you have any family history of unexplained death or sudden cardiac death in a family member younger than 35 years old? Does anyone have like an implantable cardiodefibrillator under the age of 35 in your family? Or is there any genetic cardiac diseases that run in your family? Things like hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, Marfan syndrome, things like that.
So how helpful are the sports exams in spotting at-risk kids for ongoing or imminent cardiac issues pre-ECG?
So I did some looking before coming here today, and I haven't found any studies that publish, you know, how good is the screening at finding cardiovascular disease in children. It was first introduced in 1996 for the American Heart Association and the American Academy of Pediatrics formally recommended that we do this, but I haven't found any studies or don't know of any studies that say 8% of kids get caught or, you know, 2% of kids or anything like that.
So adding in the ECG has its benefits. Let's talk about that.
Yeah.
It's an electrocardiogram. How is that done? What is it, and why do you think it's important to the pre-participation sports screening?
So ECGs look at the electrical activity and some of the structures of your heart. You stick 12 stickers that have little wires that are attached to these stickers on your chest. It takes about 20 to 30 seconds to actually get the ECG done, and then your pediatric cardiologist will read it and see if there's any abnormalities. The benefit of it is it's a further look or just more information that we have on the heart health of these athletes. Sudden cardiac arrest is the number one killer in young athletes. And in 80% of those athletes that have sudden cardiac arrest, they have no symptoms prior to the actual arrest where their heart stops.
I think we have to be clear. This is not common that the heart stops in a teenage young man or young woman. Talk about that.
No, sudden cardiac arrest, I think the incidence, depending on what you're looking at and what area and what population is about 1 in 40,000 to 1 in 80,000 people will have this happen to them. So it's certainly not common. But if it is detectable or preventable, then that's certainly something we should be looking into and figuring out how to keep our kids as healthy and as, you know, active as we possibly can.
Now, you've been researching this, and this is what you're presenting on. You're the lead author on this study, I understand?
Correct.
And you've been researching occult cardiovascular disease detected during the pre-participation sports ECG screenings. What did you find?
So ECGs are not mandatory, are not part of the nationally, are not part of the screening process for every high school athlete for her high school sports physicals. But in May of 2021, Orange County School District mandated this so that all high school athletes in Orange County School District had to have an ECG done.
And that's Orange County, Florida, which is where Nemours Children's Health is located.
Correct. It's hospital. In Orlando. It's the ninth largest school district in the entire United States. So from May 21 to May of 2022, we did 11,547 ECGs on high school athletes. About 2.7% of those, or 310 of those, were found to be abnormal. And so those kids required follow-up with a pediatric cardiologist. So of those 310, we had 105 follow-up with Nemours Children's Hospital. We don't get the entire catchment like maybe we would in Delaware, because there's three children's hospitals in Orlando. And so of those 105 that followed up with us, 15 of them were found to have a potentially life-threatening cardiac disease. 12 of them had something called Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, and then 3 of them had some form of cardiomyopathy.
So it sounds like it saved lives.
Yeah, absolutely.
The abnormalities that you find in the ECG, are they congenital? Are they acquired conditions? And if they're congenital, how were they missed?
So depending on what you're finding, they can either be acquired or have some sort of genetic component. That's part of the reason why the American Heart Association and the AAP, the American Academy of Pediatrics, ask those questions about family heart history. And sometimes you have a defect in a gene that builds a protein or a muscle in your heart that takes 15, 18, 22 years to actually kind of show a manifestation or actually affect the strength of your heart muscle. So unless we're doing genetic screening on every baby that's born in this country where you have a very significant family history where your uncle died at 22 and we know why, it's just not something we're looking for, or we would see until kids start to have either symptoms or we start to do these screenings in kind of the teenage years.
Nothing we can put in the newborn screening, or that doesn't really apply?
You could. I think there's so many different kind of genes that affect these things and so many different heart conditions that can predispose a young athlete to sudden cardiac arrest that you'd have to be sequencing the whole genome at this point to really identify all of these things.
Which might not be the most efficient way of going about that.
100%.
Now, the ECGs for every athlete, is that every year? Is it once in their career? How does that work?
So right now, it's every athlete. It can be, you know, the football player, the kid in the marching band, the kid on the soccer team. And at this point, it's only one time during their high school athletic career. So even if you play three sports, you know, in three different seasons, you only need one EKG screening the entire time you're in high school.
Let's talk about bringing this to the federal level. How far away are we to have this having this nationwide?
It's tough to say. I think in the world of pediatric cardiology, it's a controversial kind of thing, more so from the manpower that it takes to do all of these screenings. 11,500 ECGs is not a small number. It's not something that's done quickly. It's took a lot of dedication and a lot of altruism from people who volunteered their time to do these screenings, and a lot of time from the physicians who are reading these screenings. So that's really where the controversy kicks in. So it's tough to say where we're at from a national, you know, mandate. It's one thing to do in one school district, but it looks very different on a national scale. But I think if we can save one life, if we can prevent one kid from having to go through that awful experience of sudden cardiac arrest, have that family not have to go through that torture, not have that community witness somebody collapsing on the field, that's incredible. There was a student, a high school football player in a preseason game in Miami-Dade County down in Miami, who collapsed on the side of the field and had to be resuscitated in front of fans, family, other students, other faculty members. And I just can't imagine how horrific that experience must have been for that entire community.
Was he okay?
Yeah, he was resuscitated. But if we can prevent that with a 20-second EKG, then I think all of this work is worth it.
Absolutely. If I was one of those 100-plus families that found out my child has an issue, what can families do then? What are the next steps, and how do you go about supporting families as they move forward in this new journey?
So if you have an abnormal screening, you're called and told that you need to set up an appointment with a pediatric cardiologist. And so really the ECG is very much a screening tool. It's not a diagnostic tool. So once they come in and see the cardiologist, they may undergo more testing, things like an echocardiogram, which is an ultrasound of the heart to look at the actual structure of it. It may be something like a stress test where you get on a treadmill and you run for 10 minutes and we see, does your ECG change as your heart starts to beat more quickly? It really is just helping the families kind of get in touch with more resources, more support, and finding more answers of why this is an abnormal thing. It's very possible that the abnormality is benign and it's unsignificant and that you just need an extra appointment to get a clean bill of health. But I think the peace of mind that that's providing to families is certainly worth it.
In terms of research moving forward by you, what do you plan on pursuing?
So the next kind of stage of this trial is to try to reach out and work with Orlando Health and Advent Health in Orlando, Florida, to see if we can get the data from patients that had abnormal screenings that potentially would have gone and been evaluated or worked up by their team. So that's kind of the next phase of this trial. And then again, just continuing to look at the ECGs and the numbers and the data that comes out of the subsequent years as ECGs continue to be mandated in Orange County School District.
Do you see this as longitudinal?
Yeah, absolutely. The mandate, you only have to get one ECG in your high school career. So I don't think we'll have quite the volume of 11,000 that we did in the first year when we were capturing all high school athletes. But certainly the data is going to continue to be there. The kids who are identified to have significant disease are going to be followed up in clinic and, you know, continue to be watched closely by our team. So that certainly is the longitudinal aspect of it.
Let me ask about families. Are they bought into this? Do they see benefit in the ECG for their teen athletes?
I don't do a ton of the actual screening stuff. I've gone to a few of them just to kind of get an idea of the process from the athlete coming in to do the screening to the tail end where we're collecting the data after they see the cardiologist. But just the few discussions I've had with families, they're thrilled about this. You know, this is a minute of their time to have that peace of mind or one more piece of data, one more reassurance that their kid is safe when they're on the field playing sports or when they're on a jog at 6 o'clock in the morning in their neighborhood.
Do you think that's why they're bought in? Because it could save their child's life?
I think so. I think I don't have children, but being a pediatrician, parents have an unbelievable protective instinct that I think unless you have children, you don't fully understand. And every parent on this planet would do anything in their power to ensure that their child is healthy and safe. And so if that's a 1 minute appointment at their local high school to get the screening done, then they're all for it.
Dr. Zachary Boynton is the co-chief resident at Nemours Children's Hospital, Florida. He's currently applying across the nation for a fellowship in pediatric cardiology. Pediatric psychologist Dr. Erica Sood works closely with the pediatric cardiology team at Nemours Children's Health, Delaware. Her job is to take care of the psychosocial health of patients and their families. And it is the family on which she focused when presenting at the World Congress.
Supporting families is so important. You know, when we think about the health and well-being of children with cardiac conditions and other chronic illnesses, they're spending the vast majority of their time outside of the clinic setting, outside of the hospital, at home, with their families, with their parents. And by supporting parents and families, we are, in essence, supporting the children themselves. And we're helping the parents to be able to provide the support to their children.
And one of the things that you are presenting on here is how to support families who find themselves in the situation of a prenatal diagnosis of a cardiac concern. I can only imagine. I have three healthy adult children. I am fortunate, but I can only imagine what it must be like to be in that position. What immediate support can you and your team provide to not just parents, but grandparents, other caregivers in that family unit?
Absolutely. You know, there's a lot we can do. I think just helping parents and families to understand that they're not alone and that what they're feeling is normal and expected. We can't take away the shock, the distress, the pain, but we can help them to cope with those feelings, to feel less isolated, to connect with supports that are available, including peer-to-peer support, meeting with other parents who have been through this or hearing about their stories. We can help them to prepare for some of the stressors that they are very likely to experience after their baby's birth and help them develop coping strategies in advance that can be helpful not only during the pregnancy, but also after the baby's birth, when their baby's in the hospital or when they're parenting their baby at home.
In that short-term period, what do those supports look like? And also talk about in the long-term what they look like.
Sure. So, you know, we find that telehealth, and we use the Nemours app, is a very effective way to be able to access and provide support to families after a prenatal diagnosis of congenital heart disease. At that time, they're not in the hospital. They come in for appointments, but those are long appointments. They're overwhelming, and that may not be the time when we can really focus on the psychosocial topics. And so instead, being able to provide that support when they're in their home environment, we're kind of fitting into their schedule as opposed to the other way around. So I've, you know, met with families when they're caring for their other children, when they're eating dinner, when they're making dinner. Sometimes they're at work and they're taking a break from work to meet with me. And I think that's really a way that we can address some of the barriers to receiving psychological care, especially during such an overwhelming period, like when, you know, you find out during pregnancy that your baby will be born with a heart condition. And so I think, you know, using telehealth, using video appointments, using in-person appointments as well, when that is, you know, the family's preference, can be a good way to deliver this support. After the baby's birth, you know, we need to have psychologists and other mental health providers available in the cardiac center, in the hospital, so that families don't have to leave the bedside to access that support. And then in the long term, you know, we can help to connect families with mental health providers in their community. You know, and the other thing that's really important is that it's not just about mental health providers. So we can provide psychosocial support to families in every clinic visit. We developed a model called Normalize, Ask, Pause, Connect. And that is a model, it's a straightforward clinical approach for healthcare professionals that don't have mental health training and how to initiate conversations about emotional health by first normalizing the challenges that many families have, you know, asking with brief open-ended questions how the family's been doing, pausing to make sure that we communicate that we really want to know the answer, and then connecting them with available resources. And I hear a lot from parents that when they're in the hospital during that kind of acute period, they do need that support, absolutely. But they're also in a kind of survival mode, and they're just trying to put one foot in front of the other. And it may not be until weeks or months later, when their child is actually doing well medically, that they finally let their guard down, their emotions wash over them, and they don't have the supports in place to be able to handle that, and they didn't expect that to happen. And so I think, you know, by asking about emotional health and normalizing the challenges that can come up at every clinic visit or many clinic visits or during hospitalizations, we're giving families the opportunity to understand that it's normal, it's okay, this is a safe place to talk about it, and supports are available.
That's a really good point, that sometimes the emotion or the emotional issues don't really rear their heads until months, maybe even years down the line. So that's actually a very good point. You talked about barriers. What are some of the barriers to delivering psychosocial services to patients and their families?
I think we have to be flexible with scheduling, and that's something that we really try to do. So not to say, you know, we have this appointment in 2 months from now and it's at this specific time, can you make it? I think that's really not reasonable, especially when we're working with families of children with chronic illnesses. And so, you know, I think trying to be as flexible as possible as we can with scheduling those appointments is really important. I know that's not always feasible, but that is something that can help. Being able to deliver the intervention in multiple ways, right? You know, in person when they're in the hospital, but also via video appointments or telehealth. I find that stigma used to be a barrier. I do not experience that as a barrier in the same way anymore. And I think there's two reasons for that. I think one is that we, as a society, I think there's much more talk about mental health issues. And so it's kind of been normalized that, you know, it's very common. And also the need for mental health support. And so I don't see that reaction that I used to get, you know, when I introduced myself as a psychologist. If anything, people are like, oh, thank goodness, you know, you're here. Because maybe they've tried to access psychology in the past or mental health services and haven't been able to. I think the other thing is that I think we do a really nice job, both at Nemours, but I think at other hospitals as well, of integrating the psychological care or the mental health care into the medical care. And so it's presented as just a standard part of care if your child has a specific condition. In this case, it's, you know, a diagnosis of congenital heart disease, that you're going to be receiving psychological care, you're going to be receiving developmental care, and that is just standard for everybody. And so people don't worry in the way that maybe they used to, that they're being targeted or somebody caught them crying and now they called, you know, the mental health professional. So I think that has, I do not find stigma to be a barrier in the way that I think people might assume it is or that it has been in the past, but I think it's really how we present it. What still is a barrier is insurance. Insurance is absolutely a barrier to psychological services, and I think that is pretty universal. Sometimes there's carve-outs, and it's not always, you know, just because an insurance company will cover medical care at a specific institution, they don't necessarily cover the psychological care. So that can be a challenge.
So we haven't quite reached parity there yet, despite the law.
We have not.
Let's talk about what parents need versus what siblings need. Siblings need support as well. Talk a little bit about that.
You know, I think it's hard to generalize about what siblings need because they have a variety of experiences, they're at a variety of ages, developmental levels. So I would say for younger kids, it can be working with a child life specialist can be really helpful, or having a child life specialist consult with the parents about, you know, how do you explain the heart condition or the, you know, the illness or what they're going to see if they visit the hospital in a developmentally appropriate way? How do you help to support sibling understanding without causing traumatic stress symptoms in what they're going to be seeing or experiencing? So I think that's a really helpful resource. I think, you know, it depends on the sibling, right? There's some siblings that might be experiencing anxiety related to their sibling's condition and may benefit from working with a mental health professional directly. Other siblings may benefit from connecting with other kids who have siblings who have a particular medical illness and therefore have similar experiences, but that may not be direct conversation about their experiences, right? They might come together and do a craft together, and maybe they weave in, you know, some discussion about their shared experiences.
We're going to move to another of your presentations where you talk about family-centered care, the importance of it. Have we arrived at family-centered care? Let's go baseline. Let's tell folks what is meant by family-centered care.
Family-centered care is providing care in a way that there is a true partnership between parents and family members and the care team, and where the family is really a member of the care team. And families' preferences and expertise and culture is taken into account when, you know, delivering care and making decisions. Have we arrived? I think we've made progress, for sure. I think we still have a ways to go. At this stage, parents, I think at most children's hospitals, are, you know, invited to participate in rounds. That's something that wasn't always the case and now is, and that's wonderful. And it's hard to believe that that ever was not the case, actually. But, you know, but there's a difference between having a parent be present and a parent being a true partner in that discussion. And I think sometimes the parent is a true partner and sometimes they are just present and they're listening. And that may be because, you know, the medical team is using a lot of words and phrases that they don't understand and they don't know and that are not common, you know, in the general language that anybody really knows unless you have medical training and acronyms. And so we have to make sure that obviously when we're communicating with parents and trying to partner with parents that we're using terms that everybody understands. You know, I think that there's parents are able to be, you know, in, let's say, the cardiac intensive care unit at all times, right? They're not being asked to leave at certain times in the way that maybe, you know, a decade ago they were. But it's still too frequent that we see a parent sitting at the bedside on their phone, not sure what they can do to help their child. And so we really need to continue to work on not just providing the care for the baby or for the child with the parent present, but really supporting the parent to be, you know, an active member of that care team.
So it sounds like we're almost there. Not quite, but yeah, almost there. What are some of the barriers that are keeping us from fully achieving family-centered care specific to developmental care for inpatients with congenital heart disease?
There are, I think, a number of barriers. So one is language barriers. We have parents that are not English-speaking. There's a lot of informal conversation that happens at the bedside with, you know, let's say the bedside nurse that ends up being, number one, supportive, number two, education. And maybe the nurse, when they came in, they weren't expecting to educate the parent, but the conversation started and it results in support and education. And as a result, that parent may feel more confident in being involved in care. And I think when there are language barriers, there may be an interpreter or, you know, language line or an iPad interpreter, but that's not always turned on at a time when the nurse is just coming in to do a quick, you know, quick check or care. I have not done this research, but I'd be very interested to know the amount of dialogue that occurs, you know, in a room where the parent is English speaking versus when the parent is non-English speaking. And I think that's something that is a disparity and that we really need to be thinking about. Parents aren't always able to be at the hospital, and there's a number of reasons for that, especially, you know, during COVID or during flu season when siblings are not allowed in the hospital or in the ICU. It can be very hard for parents to get to the hospital, to spend a substantial amount of time there, to even get there for education because they have siblings to care for and they may live a distance away and the sibling is not allowed in the hospital and there is no childcare option. That is a real barrier, I think, to any type of education and developmental care. I think parental fear can also get in the way of, you know, this is a very overwhelming experience. And when you see your baby with tubes and lines and monitors and beeping, and I think many parents talk about, you know, I'm worried I'm going to break my baby. And so, you know, we as a care team really need to support the parent in beginning to feel comfortable in providing that care for their babies and really switching the approach from like, here are the things you can't do to here are the things you can do, even when your baby's very sick and attached to 100 things, here are the things you can do.
Do you know of course, without going into any privacy issues, but can you, off the top of your head, give us a patient story that sticks with you with regard to either the importance of family-centered care or the importance of just having the family and supporting the family that has the sick child that's been successful?
So I can talk about a quality improvement project that we have been doing in the Nemours Cardiac Center, led by Carly Negrin, who is our feeding therapist. And she has done a terrific job of initiating we call it the first feed project. So ensuring that parents have the opportunity to be present at their baby's first feeding experience. And it seems obvious, well, of course, the parent should be present at the first feeding experience. But in the medical setting, you know, once that baby is cleared to be fed, oftentimes it's just a task on the list. And people don't think about how important that is for that mother or that father to feed their baby for the first time and then to come into the hospital and find out that your baby was fed and you weren't even notified. And so this is something that the team has been working on and has really made great progress in this. And, you know, I think it's something that has really greatly impacted many of our families to have that experience. And again, not just to be present for it, but to be able to actually participate in it, whether it's the parent is holding the baby, whether the parent is supporting the baby in some way while the speech therapist is feeding the baby, or whether the parent is feeding the baby themselves, you know, making sure that the parent has a really important role.
And what has been the reaction of parents to that? I would think it would be overwhelmingly positive, but I could be wrong.
No, it is. Absolutely. And I think it's overwhelmingly negative when they're not informed and find out later.
Anything else you wanted to share about the work that you're doing, especially with families, which is so very important?
I can talk about another project that we're doing. We have developed, and this is with our one of our cardiac intensivists and our physical therapy and OT teams, holding guidelines to ensure that babies are out of bed in their parents' arms as soon as they are medically able to be. And there, at times, there can be inconsistencies in when babies are able to get out of bed based on who the attending is or who the nurse is or what's going on in the unit. And the goal behind these guidelines are that this is something that can standardize that so that parents don't have the experience of coming in one day and being able to hold their baby and then coming in the next day and being told that for whatever reason, their baby can't be out of bed in their arms. That can be a very upsetting and frustrating experience for parents. So that's something that we're really trying to address.
It may be obvious and an obvious question, but what are the benefits of that?
I think it is obvious, you know, having your baby in your arms is clearly beneficial. And that's, you know, that's what your baby's brain and body expects, right? You know, when you think about a typical healthy baby going home from the hospital, they are expecting to be held by their parents. And so as much as we can try to kind of mimic that normative experience in the CICU and in our cardiac center, you know, the better.
Well beyond medicine.
Thanks for listening to our conversations recorded at the 8th World Congress of Pediatric Cardiology and Cardiac Surgery in Washington, D.C. with me, Carol Vassar, and our guests, Dr. Erica Sood, who you just heard, and Dr. Zachary Boynton. The Well Beyond Medicine podcast truck is coming to Jacksonville on October 5th as we celebrate Well Beyond Medicine Day. That's your chance to stop by, say hello, and chat on the record on what Well Beyond Medicine means to you. If Jacksonville is not on your itinerary, visit the podcast website, nemourswellbeyond.org. Leave us a voicemail there with your take on the phrase well beyond medicine or your feedback and ideas for upcoming episodes. That's nemourswellbeyond.org. While you're there, check out our other episodes and subscribe to the podcast. Thanks to Che Parker, Susan Masucci, and Cheryl Munn for their production assistance. Join us next time as we head to the city of brotherly love to hear from a Nemours patient and her family about her fight against cancer and Nemours' new partnership with the Philadelphia Phillies. Until then, remember, together we can change children's health for good, well beyond medicine.
Let's go! Oh, oh. Well beyond medicine.